Thank you. What if I told you that there is an invisible war happening all around us, and each and every one of us in this room is at risk for being a casualty at any moment? The global recession taking place right now was foretold over 20 years ago. At the very earliest stages of the internet boom, people from all over the world were getting rich quick, from suddenly expanding into a cyber environment. This collective global growth that occurred as a result of the internet boom in the late 90s and early 2000s was never sustainable. For those who were paying attention to all the signs around them, the massive opportunity for expansion only foretold the transition of various types of business operations, both legal and illegal, to the digital space. This stealthy shift has left a society of individuals quickly adopting to a new way of life, while rarely acknowledging the signs that they would, at some point, be victimized in the digital space. Everyone in this room and watching this TEDx talk will be victim of cybercrime at some point. It is no longer a question of if you will be a victim, so much as when. Think about it, applying for a job, filing taxes, purchasing groceries, scheduling a doctor's appointment, checking bank accounts, all of this happens online and requires the transfer of sensitive information. This is a story of how cybercrime hurts some groups more than others, and how while making the internet essential for all, we only made it safe for some. New digital technologies have made for a more global, open, and transparent world where access to information is, in theory, much easier to come by. This same openness has caused new forms of crime, with access to networks and free-for-all data, making digital forms of crime more frequent than ever. Fictional comic book character Harley Quinn once said, "People hate what they can't understand." I, for one, knows what it feels like to be misunderstood. My name is Dr. Angel Durr, and I'm a data scientist, professor, entrepreneur, and a person who happens to have been raised by an early stage female cyber criminal. I stand before you as, among many other things, as a Black, Latina, autistic, Jewish, disabled mother. While my background has primarily been in data alone, securing that data has been of the utmost importance to me for as long as I can remember. I join you after suddenly being thrust into a fight I had no idea I would be in only a few years ago. My mother was murdered last April in South Dallas after a lifetime that included stints in federal prison. Her murder remains unsolved to this day. I want to flip the script on this event and honor my mother's memory by sharing her story in hopes of changing how we view both the tools we use to fight against cybercrime, as well as discussing the human toll that internet-based crime has on the entire world, especially since COVID. So what is cybercrime? Cybercrime is the act of overpowering people by attacking what is both crucial and private and in public spheres, i.e. data. Even though the attacks consist of preventing access to data, not actually stealing data, it is one of the most major and serious types of attacks faced by businesses. Having no access to your data means you cannot operate. Thus, cybercrime clearly underscores how valuable and pivotal data is. It is today's new black gold. If data had no value, there would be no cyber criminals. It is therefore today one of the most important commodities. Kidnapping for ransom or hostage taking of personal data and is using that information as a hostage. As of 2021, the annual GDP of cybercrime was $6 billion. That means it would be the third largest country in the world, second only to the United States and China. On average, hackers attack 26,000 times a day, globally, according to Forbes. That means an attack happens on average every 3 seconds. With that figure in mind, there will be roughly 240 global attacks and an estimated $132 million in cybercrime damage by the time I finish my speech alone. And one of you may be the victims to that. They steal credentials or buy them on the dark web. It's as cheap as a dollar to buy a malware bot on the black web. So what we're seeing is that criminals are mimicking the rest of the tech bubble as we are truly seeing what amounts to cybercrime as a service. So organized cyber gang leaders, the same ones that we're all used to, the same organized crimes and mafias, have shifted to the digital space where they can use weapons and violence, but also money and bribes to buy elections, politicians, and power, and do so in a way that is not traceable. Even members of the military are involved. So let's turn to the victims of cybercrime. Minorities, women, and those from disadvantaged backgrounds like myself bear the disproportionate burden when it comes to cybercrime. There is far too little done for those who are brave enough to come forward after being victimized by cybercrime activities. As I've witnessed firsthand over the last year and a half of losing my mother to gun violence, fear can corrode trust, even in people who might be trying to help. I personally can recall being victimized by my own mother young. I've met other victims who still bring up this type of victimization well into late age. So clearly, even with cybercrime, there's a long-standing impact on a person. We need much better data on the direct and indirect costs of cybercrime globally in a way that moves beyond the dollar values to get to the actual humanity that lives beneath. My mother's homicide is just one of what I suspect are millions of people who have lost their lives at the hands of cybercrime. At this point, there is no crime that at some point isn't considered cybercrime either. So artificial intelligence is equipping any non-living entity with the cognition required for human-like decision-making. AI isn't just the robots, it's the self-replicating program that can quickly and accurately find and expose vulnerabilities that end up making it possible to bankrupt an entire organization in a matter of minutes or seconds. Automatically deploying AI-enabled tech that can quickly learn to analyze and detect patterns and monitor incidents that clock at scale is for billions of data points at one time makes it possible for us to evaluate risk at the scale and capacity at which it's necessary given the amount of cybercrime going on. We must prepare ourselves for adversaries who will exploit AI methods to increase the coverage of their own attacks, the speed of attacks, and the likelihood of successful outcomes. So we aren't the only ones using AI in social engineering. So are the bad guys. Social engineering is the tactic of manipulating, influencing, or deceiving a victim in order to gain control over a computer system or to steal financial information. Human perception and psychology are extremely weak links in cyber defense. AI can be used to exploit the persistent vulnerability. AI methods can be used to generate ultra-personalized phishing attacks capable of fooling even the most security-conscious users. Cybercriminals can easily reverse engineer tools as well, and systems that are available for public business and personal use to make it easier to find vulnerabilities and strike. So both defense and offense tactics in cybercrime prevention will need to be more sophisticated in nature. Despite a global footprint, the disparate international treatment of cybercrime is very apparent. We are a long way from a uniform approach, but finding common ground to work from, like we were able to do in the COVID response, is essential. We are living in an age of crime without borders. A borderless crime is a remote threat, and therefore detection and punishment must often happen at the global level where there's limited jurisdiction. It should be noted that there's a difference between countries unwilling to fight the fight against cybercrime and those who just don't have the resources to, because the digital divide and cybercrime go together like peas and carrots. Fictional DC superhero Harley Quinn has become a symbol of mischief and chaos that sometimes eclipses her more redeeming qualities, like being a Virgo. However, this duality that Harley has is what makes her such a compelling anti-heroine and PhD. I myself can't say that this is far from my own reality as a first-generation college student and PhD with a father for a pension for gambling, who has a history that includes a deep fake appearance on reality TV's Extreme Cheapskates. In addition to the murder of my mother, who after serving time and being released from federal prison for early stage cybercrime, was victimized one final time. Despite her criminal activities, to me, she was just a mom. But hurt people hurt people.
My mother, like many people, chose a life of crime after being victimized by the systems of power as an autistic Black woman. This left my mother with chronic conditions that made it extremely difficult to maintain steady employment despite how intelligent she was. Therefore, she felt like crime was the only way out of poverty. Breaking up silos and data is critical to mitigating the risk that comes with data that is not centralized and standardized in a compliance-ready format. However, breaking down the silos of individuals who are currently leading the fight against cybercrime is just as important. As I give this talk, there's a global shortage of 2.72 million cybersecurity professionals. So lots of job openings, folks, according to the 2021 Cybersecurity Workforce Study. A lack of diversity of people, women, Black cybersecurity professionals, Hispanic cybersecurity professionals, the neurodiverse. It makes organizations weaker to vulnerabilities when they have a homogenous workforce that is more susceptible to groupthink. The best way to protect yourself from this kind of attack is to enable a two-factor authentication wherever and whenever possible. Let's start with some basics of cyber hygiene. Easy and common sense ways to protect yourself online. Update your software. In fact, turn on automatic updates. Think before you click. More than 90% of successful cyber attacks start with a phishing email or text. Use strong passwords and a password manager to generate and store unique passwords. Predictability with online behavior is the key to what makes cybercriminals successful. The less predictable our behavior, the less likely we are to be victimized. So stay unpredictable. Thank you and stay safe out there, folks.